Hi friends, I welcome you for this sixth lecture. Myself, Dr. Mahesh Lohit KS, Associate Professor and Head, Department of Physics, ATME College of Engineering, here to discuss Module 3 of Engineering Physics, 18 PHY 12 bar 22. In continuation of our previous discussions, today we shall discuss the theorems related to the Maxwell's equations, which lead to the formulation of Maxwell's equations. The topics of today's discussion are the Bayou-Savart law, then Faraday's laws of electromagnetic induction, then equation of continuity, which leads to the concept of displacement current, then Maxwell-Ampere law. Maxwell introduced a correction to Ampere's law to overcome the inconsistency of Ampere's law with respect to the equation of continuity. Then finally, we are going to study the displacement current, and also we are going to derive an expression for the displacement current. The first topic of today's discussion is Bayou-Savart law. This Bayou-Savart law gives a small magnetic field at any point P near a current carrying conductor due to a current element of the conductor. Let us study this Bayou-Savart law. Let us say there is a point P here at a distance r from a small elemental length of a conductor dl. So, this is called as the current element dl, and r is the distance between the center of the current element and the point, and it is denoted by the position vector r, vector r, and which is nothing but r into r cap. R cap is the unit vector in that direction, and dl is the current element. The current element makes an angle theta with respect to the line joining the current element with the point. So, and I is the current that flows through the current element. So, in this case, the magnetic field, the magnitude of the magnetic field dB, which is a small magnetic field due to the current element, is given by or is proportional to the current through the element. More the current through the element, more the magnitude of the magnetic field. Then it is proportional to the length of the current element, that is dl, and also it is directly proportional to sine of the angle theta. Theta is the angle between the current element and the line joining the current element with the point, and it is inversely proportional to square of the distance between the point and the current element. So, here we can replace this proportionality with a constant, and we get this equation, that is the magnitude of magnetic field or magnetic flux density at P is given by mu naught by 4 pi into idl sin theta by r square. Now, here we have a term dl sin theta, and this dl sin theta could be written as dl cross r cap. R cap is the unit vector. What is that we get when we take the cross product of these two? dl cross r could be written as dl into magnitude of unit vector. Magnitude of unit vector is 1, then sine of the angle theta into n cap. So, what is this n cap? N cap is a unit vector perpendicular to the plane containing this element and this r, vector r or r cap. So, the vector r and the elemental length are both are in the plane of the screen, and this dB is perpendicular to the plane of the screen. In this case, it is into the screen. The direction of the magnetic field is into the plane of the screen. So, therefore, we can replace this dl sin theta by dl cross r cap. So, we get this equation, and we know that any unit vector could be written as the vector by its magnitude. The vector by its magnitude, we can write this as r by vector r by its magnitude. So, if we substitute In place of r cap, we get vector r, whereas in the denominator, it becomes r cube. So, the small magnetic field at any point near the current element of a conductor is given by mu naught by 4 pi Idl cross r divided by r cube, and this is the Biot-Savart law. The next topic of today's discussion is Faraday's laws of electromagnetic induction, and it relates the interacting electric and magnetic fields. The first statement is, whenever there is a change in flux linked with the circuit, an EMF is induced, and the induced EMF is proportional to the rate of change of magnetic flux. And the second part states that the EMF is induced so that it opposes the cause, means it opposes the rate of change of flux. Mathematically, this could be written as E, that is the induced EMF, is equal to minus d phi by dt. D phi by dt is the rate of change of flux and E is the induced EMF. The negative sign indicates that this EMF induced, it opposes the cause, that is the rate of change of flux. This is for a coil with single turn, one turn. If the coil has n number of turns, then the EMF induced is n d phi by dt. So, for example, if we consider a coil like this, then let us say we have a magnet here, this is north and this south of a magnet, and this magnet is moved towards the coil, and there is magnetic flux that is interacting with the circuit. Okay. Then when it is moved, there is a rate of change of flux, and an EMF is induced in this coil. The induced EMF induces induced current, and the current flows in such a direction that the face of the coil that is facing the north pole, okay, develops a north pole. So, it opposes the cause. Faraday's law could be expressed both in integral and differential forms, and the differential form is also called as a point form. This is the Faraday's law of electromagnetic induction in integral form. It has two parts. This is the first part and this is the second part. The first part describes the EMF induced, and the second part describes the rate of change of flux linked with the circuit. Now, let us understand this. See, let us say there is a positive charge here. And at infinity, what do you mean by infinity? It is a distance at which there is no influence of this charge on another charge. Let us consider a 1 coulomb charge here, which is at infinity. Now, if we move this charge in steps of infinitesimally small lengths, so that the electric field is assumed to be constant throughout this length, small elemental length, then work is done in steps, and finally, let us say we reach this point, let us say this is x. Now, the total work done in moving the charge from infinity to x is stored as potential energy, and that potential energy by charge, where q is this charge, okay, potential energy per unit charge is nothing but the electrostatic potential. So, V is equal to W by q. Now, this electrostatic potential is obtained by this equation. What is this W? W is nothing but the work done, and it is the dot product of force and displacement. Since we are moving 1 coulomb of charge, so it could be considered as the dot product of E into dl, force and electric field, they are equal in magnitude when we consider 1 coulomb of charge. This E dot dl gives you the work done, in moving the charge through this small displacement dl. Then the total work done in moving the charge from infinity to the point of consideration could be written as integral over a path, it is a line integral, that is E dot dl. So, it gives the potential of this charge. So with the similar concern, we can apply this E dot dl over a closed path to a coil. Let us say we have a coil here and there is a magnet here. Let us say this is north pole of a magnet, this is south pole of a magnet, and these are the field lines coming out of the magnet. When the magnet is moved towards the coil, there will be a rate of change of flux associated with the coil, due to which an EMF is induced. EMF is nothing but it is measured as the potential difference in a circuit. Let us assume that EMF is equal to the potential difference, then we can consider that this closed path for current is divided into large number of small elements like this. So here there is electric field inside this conductor. Okay, so this is the elemental length dl. So we take the product of E dot dl, and if integrate, this left hand side gives the EMF. Now the right hand side gives the rate of change of flux, that is dou by d dou t of integral over a surface B dot ds. What is this B dot ds? We can consider that this particular surface or area is divided into large number of small elements. So we can calculate the flux through each area using using the dot product, that is B dot ds. This gives the small flux through a say elementary area that is considered here. Now the total flux linked with the coil is given by integral over a surface, that is throughout this surface, B dot ds. Then the rate of change of flux, this gives the flux, then the rate of change of flux is dou by dou t phi, this is the total flux, and hence we get this right hand side. So there is a third part here. Third part is integral over a surface, the curl of E, and this is obtained from the first part by applying Stokes theorem. So by we apply Stokes theorem and we get this. So the Stokes theorem states that the integral over a closed path, which is called circulation, could be written as integral over a surface of curl of the vector field. So therefore we get this. Now we can equate this second term and the third term. When we equate the second term and the third term, we get this dou by dou t of B. See, we can swap these two operators. This is a spatial integral, this is a time differential. So therefore we can swap these two. So if we swap, we take it this, take this operator inside, we get minus dou B by dou t. So this differential operates on B, therefore we can equate the curl of E with minus dou B by dou t, which is the rate of change of magnetic flux density. So therefore we can write this, the curl of E, as minus dou B by dou t. So therefore we have the Faraday's laws of electromagnetic induction in the point form or differential form, and this is the third Maxwell's equation. The next topic of discussion is equation of continuity. This equation of continuity is based on, or it is nothing but law of conservation of charges, law of conservation of charges. So we consider a Gaussian surface here. There is a Gaussian surface, this is the Gaussian surface S, and it encloses a volume V, and there is a distribution of charge throughout this volume. Let us say positive charges are distributed. If the charges they move out, there will be current. Okay. Now these charges are crossing a surface. So we speak only in terms of current density. So what is current density? Current density is J, and current could be expressed as the dot product of J and area. Here we can assume that this Gaussian surface is made of a large number of small elementary areas. then each area, if it is ds, this j dot ds gives the current through this area, right? So if we integrate, we get the total current that is coming out of this surface, the total current, okay? When this happens, the density of the positive charges goes on decreasing inside the volume, because charges are moving out, the total number of charges goes on decreasing. Therefore, there is a rate change of density of charge. So, the equation of continuity could be written as this integral over a j, you know, integral over a surface, that is j dot ds, current density and the area vector. This gives the total current that is going through this surface, and on the right hand side this integral over rho v dv represents the charge, the total charge inside this volume, because charge density into volume is charge, and this dou by dou t takes care of rate of change of the charge, rate variation of charge in this volume. So therefore, this current, you know, it depends on the rate of change of charge density. The negative sign indicates that the positive charges, the number of positive charges goes on decreasing, or the during the rate variation the positive charges are moving out and the charge density of positive charges goes on decreasing. So this is the equation of continuity. So it could be expressed in the form of a statement. It states that in all processes involving motion of charge or charges or charge carriers, the net charge is always conserved and is called the law of conservation of charge. See, here let us apply that law of conservation of charge. Whatever the charge, you know, is lost from the volume, it comes out. It is, you know, it results in current. So whatever the charge comes out, it will be outside here and it constitutes current, and that charge is lost from this volume. Okay? Charge is there somewhere, it cannot be destroyed, you know, it is here somewhere. So this is nothing but the law of conservation of charge, right? And this could also be written in the form of the divergence of J as minus dou rho v by dou t, and this divergence of J indicates that it is a source of current or current density. So this volume here, okay, here it represents, see, it is divergence of J. Divergence of J means this is a source of positive charges, and due to this divergence the charges they move out, and due to which there is a reduction in the positive charge density. Therefore, this is the point form. How do we arrive at this point form? So we know that the Gauss divergence theorem relates the surface integral with a volume integral. So therefore, we can write this left hand side LHS part as integral over a volume, divergence of J over a volume dV, over a volume V, and it is divergence of J over, you know, dV. So we can equate this with the right hand side. So when we equate, we get this equation. So this is the equation of continuity. So let us have a discussion on this equation of continuity. So this equation of continuity is given by the divergence of current density, and that is equal to the rate of change of charge density. As I told you, there is a divergence, so there is a source of current density, and this, due to this source, the positive charges are drained from that particular region, and hence there is a change in density of charges. So it is minus d rho by dt. As per Ampere's law, we know the Ampere's law, that is del cross H is equal to J, which could also be written as the curl of B, that is equal to mu naught J. So this is Ampere's law. So we have a small discussion here. We do some modifications here, and we will check the consistency of this Ampere's law. So we take this equation, we take divergence on both sides, divergence on the left side. Divergence means it is del dot, then even on the right hand side we take the divergence, it is del dot. So when we do that, we get this equation. See, in case of this magnetic field, in case of divergence of curl is always 0. So divergence of curl is 0 because the magnetic field lines are, the magnetic flux or field lines, they are concentric circles. So they are purely in the circular path, they are purely swirling. When something is purely swirling, there will be no divergence. Therefore, divergence of curl of magnetic flux density is 0. So it means this LHS will be 0. But RHS may be 0 or may not be 0. See, as per the mathematics, if LHS is 0, RHS has to be 0. But RHS is not always 0, but this left hand side, as per this divergence of curl is 0, it is always 0, but RHS need not be 0 always. So what is the meaning of this? So this RHS will be 0 only when the field is static, okay, or there is no rate of change of charge. When I say DC, static field means DC current, the total charge that enters, the same amount of charge leaves, therefore there is no net change of charges in this particular region. The net change, there is no change in charge density here. Whatever the electron enters, the electron leaves. Whatever the positive charge enters, the same leaves. So there is no net accumulation, therefore the rate of change of charge with respect to time is 0 in case of static fields. But in case of time varying fields, this dou rho by dou t is not 0. So it means that RHS is not 0, but LHS is 0 where there is inconsistency. So therefore, Ampere's law has inconsistency with respect to the equation of continuity. Since the Ampere's law is inconsistent with the equation of continuity, Maxwell introduced a correction term to rescue the Ampere's law from the inconsistency with respect to the equation of continuity. He introduced a correction term, and let us derive the correction term. We know that the divergence of flux density is given by rho v. This is the first Maxwell's equation. As per first Maxwell's equation, we have this, the divergence of d is equal to rho v. By taking the time differential on both sides, this equation, we get this equation here. We have taken the time derivative on both sides. This being a time derivative, it does not act on the spatial derivative. This del is a spatial derivative. So this does not act on this, it acts only on this d, that is electric flux density. Therefore, this equation could be written as the divergence of rate of change of flux density with respect to time, electric flux density with respect to time is equal to rate of change of charge density, this equation. And according to the equation of continuity, we know that the divergence of the current density is minus the rate change of the charge density. So we can substitute for this here in this equation, okay, in this equation here. So if we substitute, we get the divergence of current density is minus divergence of the rate change of the electric flux density. So we can take this to LHS. So this del could be taken out, okay, and this could be written as del dot, that is divergence of J plus the rate of change of electric flux density, that is 0. Okay. Now, according to the Maxwell-Ampere law, the divergence of J plus the rate change of electric flux density is 0. It is not just the divergence of J is equal to 0. Therefore, in Ampere's law, we need to replace this J with J plus dou d by dou t. So that is the conclusion. Therefore, Ampere's law becomes the curl of H is equal to j plus dou d by dou t, okay, or we can say this is equal to, okay, j plus j d. This j is the current density and j d stands for displacement current density. Now, let us understand this displacement current density. According to Maxwell-Ampere law, the curl of H is j plus dou d by dou t, that is j plus j d, this is the displacement current density. And this term j d, what is the origin of this and is it due to the physical motion of charges? No, it is not due to the physical motion of charges. Okay, it is not due to the physical motion of charges, okay, but it is due to the varying time varying electric field. It is due to the time varying electric field. So, the origin of this J d is due to the time varying electric field and its unit is same as the unit of current density. Whenever there is a change in electric field, there is a magnetic field associated. So, therefore, the origin of this displacement current density is the time varying electric field. So, it is associated with a magnetic field. So, what is the definition for this displacement current density? The displacement current density is a correction factor introduced by Maxwell in order to explain the continuity of electric current in time varying circuits or AC circuits. So, for example, we can consider a capacitor. There is a current when the capacitor is charging. Let us say here there is a capacitor and it is connected to a source, and as soon as the switch is closed, the current is flowing, the capacitor is charging. There is a current in the conductor, but there is no current between the plates, there is no flow of physical charges. So, to explain this, Maxwell introduced a concept of displacement current density. The current that flows between the plates is nothing but the displacement current. The last topic of today's discussion is a derivation of expression for displacement current. For this, we consider an AC circuit containing a capacitor. So, there is a capacitor here connected to an AC source, and current is there is physical current here, there is physical current here, physical current is due to the flow of physical charges. Now, this capacitor is depicted here in this picture. These are the two plates of the capacitor. Current is entering the capacitor, that is physical current, and physical current is leaving the capacitor. Here we consider a small cylindrical surface. Surface L of this cylindrical surface lies outside, whereas this surface R lies between the plates of the capacitor, or it encloses one plate of the capacitor. Here the physical current is coming out of this surface L, whereas there is no physical current that is entering this surface R. So, there is an inconsistency, there is current here, there is no current. So, to overcome this inconsistency, a correction factor is introduced by Maxwell, and that is nothing but the displacement current between the plates, and the displacement current enters this surface R and the current I leaves this left surface L. So, to derive the expression, let us consider the expression for displacement current in terms of the displacement current density. See, between the plates, if you consider the area of cross section here, this area of cross section is represented by a area vector which is in this direction, and electric field between the plates is also in the same direction, okay, and the current density, displacement current density, is also in the same direction. So, displacement current density and area, they are in the same direction, and hence we can write this displacement current as displacement current density into area. So, this dot product can be replaced by a product itself. Here A is the area of the capacitor plates and D is the electric flux density. And we know that electric flux density D is equal to epsilon E. This is equation 17, remember. Here epsilon is absolute permittivity, which is epsilon naught epsilon r, permittivity of free space, and epsilon r is the relative permittivity. So, epsilon is the product of these two, and E is the electric field between the plates, that is electric field strength. It could be written as V by D. Here V is the potential difference between the plates and D is the separation between the plates. The voltage applied across the plates of the capacitor is an AC voltage. So, it is given by V is equal to V s e power j omega t. This is the equation. So, using equations 17, 18 and 19. So, we know that this E is equal to V by D and D is equal to epsilon E. So, this E could be replaced by V by D. So, therefore, this D is epsilon by D into V, and this V, if we substitute, we get V e power j omega t. So, we have this equation. Now, the displacement current is given by the time derivative of this D. D is given by this. So, substitute into A. So, if you differentiate, this epsilon is a constant, D is a constant, it comes out, epsilon and D, they come out. When you differentiate this V s e power j omega t, this V s is a constant, that is the amplitude, it stays outside, it does not vary with respect to time. When you differentiate this with e power j omega t, we will get j omega. So, we have j into omega, and this A comes here. And differential of e power j omega t is j omega into e power j omega t. Therefore, this e power j omega t remains as it is. So, the displacement current is given by j omega epsilon A divided by D that is into V s e power j omega t, and is the expression for the displacement current. So, finally, we shall group all the four Maxwell's equations to refer in the next topic, that is for electromagnetic waves. For time varying fields, the Gauss law of electrostatics is given by divergence of D is the charge density. The Faraday's law of electromagnetic induction is given by the curl of electric field is the negative time differential of the magnetic flux density, that is minus dou v by dou t. Then Gauss law of magnetic fields gives the divergence of magnetic flux density is 0. And the fourth one is Maxwell Ampere law, that is curl of H is equal to current density plus displacement current density. Having discussed the Maxwell's equations for time varying fields, now we shall also state the four Maxwell's equations for the static fields. The first equation is Gauss law of electrostatics. It is the divergence of electric flux density is equal to the charge density. The second equation is Faraday's law of electromagnetic induction. It states the curl of electric field is 0. So, this is for static field, and the next or third Maxwell equation is Gauss law of magnetism. The divergence of magnetic flux density B or magnetic field is 0. Then the fourth one, the Maxwell Ampere law, the curl of H is equal to the current density. So, these are the four Maxwell's equations for static fields. Finally, we shall summarize our discussion that we had today. The first topic of discussion is the Bayo-Savala. Bayo-Savala gives an expression for magnetic field near a current element of a conductor. Then we discuss Faraday's laws of electromagnetic induction. It describes the interacting electric and magnetic fields and the relation between them. And next topic of discussion is equation of continuity. The equation of continuity is based on the law of conservation of charges. If we consider charges, positive charges enclosed by a volume, the charges are enclosed by a Gaussian surface which encloses a volume. If the charges move out, or if the charges pass through the surface, there will be current density, and as there is current density, the total charge inside the volume decreases. So this is what is called the equation of continuity. Then we had a discussion on equation of continuity. In that we studied the inconsistency of Ampere's law. Ampere's law could able to explain DC circuits, but it failed to explain the AC circuits. So in order to overcome this inconsistency, Maxwell introduced a correction to Ampere's law, and is called Maxwell-Ampere law, and the correction term is displacement current density. And finally we derived an expression for displacement current, and displacement current he has the origin of time varying electric field. So with this we have come to the end of the session. So in order to just assess ourselves, we have two multiple choice questions. The first multiple choice question is, the law that relates the interacting electric and magnetic fields is. So there are four options here: Ampere's law, the first one; second one, Maxwell Ampere law; the third one, Faraday's law; and fourth one, Bayosawala. Please choose your answer. Yes friends, obviously it is Faraday's law. Faraday's laws of electromagnetic induction relates the interacting electric and magnetic fields. So option, the correct option is 3, Faraday's law. The second multiple choice question, the displacement current is the consequence of flow off. So what is the origin of this displacement current? There are four options: positive charges, negative charges, time varying magnetic field, and time varying electric field. Please pick your answer. Yes friends, the displacement current, as per the definition, it is not due to the physical flow of charges, it is not the physical current. So hence options 1 and 2 are wrong. And from the Maxwell Ampere law, we know that this displacement current has an origin of a time varying electric field, and hence the correct option is option 4. So option 4 is the correct answer. With this we have come to the end of today's session, and let us close the session with a quote by Nikola Tesla. Nikola Tesla quotes, "The present is theirs, the future for which I really work is mine." A great scientist, Nikola Tesla. So with this we shall close the today's session. So wish you all the best. Have a great day.